1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14 on down. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14 to verse 22. Let me give you a little bit about the contents of this particular scripture here. It has to do with the church at Corinth. The first letter that Paul writes to this church to set things in order, to bring them back to the reality of what really took place when they received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he deals with a problem of idol worshiping and meat sacrificed to idols and things like that. So on verse 14, it's about to conclude, brings a very important message. And he says, "Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak as to wise men, judge ye what I say. The cup of the blessings which ye bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which ye break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body. For we're all partakers of the one bread. Behold, Israel after the flesh. Are not they which eat of the sacrifices partakers of the altar? What I say then, that the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything? But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils. Do you provoke the Lord to jealousy? Or are you stronger than he?" For those of you that are here for the first time, and you're looking at all these tables here with a lot of things on them, we have started out to teach and preach on the tables in the Bible and what they contain, what they stand for. Before I go and identify what we're doing here, let me say that the word table is a place or a piece of furniture or an area, let me put it that way, that it's a flat surface, okay? That's a table. And normally when we talk about table, we think about the kitchen table, the dining room table, and there's nothing wrong with that. We see that every day, don't we? But actually the table that the Bible is referring to is a table so that everybody can see what's on the table. Everybody can see God's plan, everybody can see God's purpose, and believe me, that's the purpose of God. You've heard the expression, what are you going to bring to the table? That's an expression between two business partners that are trying to cut a deal. One brings the money and the other one is going to bring the expertise, and they ask each other, what are you bringing to the table? And the one with expertise says, well, I'm going to bring all my experience and I'm going to put it on the table. In other words, so you can see my qualities, they're on the table. And the other one say, well, my money is on the table too. So we can do business. So God has intentions of people being honest and being trustworthy and bring things to the table so that everybody can see our heart and our emotions and everything. And then you heard the expression, he took money under the table. All right? That's very common nowadays. They take money under the table. They think that nobody saw it. When they're taking money under the table, that means that they don't want to show it on top. And normally that's when people want to steal from the IRS, when people want to do business and take bribes and stuff like that, they put money under the table. Well, that has no part in the kingdom of God because it's hidden things when they're supposed to be out in the open. God wants for us to be truthful and everything out in the open. So table plays a very important role in our society. And now let me go back and kind of explain a little bit about each of the tables. We can go to the third table, which is that one there. First of all, this table is a Jewish table. And it's a progressive table. The table is written in the book of Exodus for us to understand God's accomplishments and God's going forward with his plans. And actually, this table started back in the creation time when Jesus... for when God told the serpent that the seed of the woman was going to bruise him in the head, and the Satan's seed was going to bruise the seed of the woman in the heel, meaning that God was prophesying already that a Savior was going to come that was going to overcome Satan. So this table was brewing 2,500 years before. And then when the nation of Israel went into bondage for 400 years, and when God decided to bring them out, something wonderful happened that is so relevant for us today. What happened here is that the people of Israel were in bondage and they were suffering. And the Word of God says that God heard the cry of the Israelites and how they were being tortured. And he heard the cry, and then he says, and I'm going to go and deliver them. So this table is speaking to us today. Now that we have the Bible complete, we can understand more about this table. But this table, the Jewish table, the Jewish nation, the Jewish people are telling us this table is Jewish, and I want to tell the whole world that God is a compassionate God. God had compassion in us, so much compassion that it was not just words, but he sent a deliverer named Moses, and he delivered us. He delivered us, and after he delivered us, he gave us hope. And when he gave us hope, not only did he give us hope in words, but he provided for us. So it's a table of compassion, of deliverance, of hope, and of blessings. And this is what happened. Now let me ask you a question so you can understand more, a little bit of what I'm saying. Did God bring the nation of Israel out of Egypt? Did he bring him in through the wilderness all the way to the promised land? And we're not going to explain that in detail, but all this was accomplished. So this is a table that has already been accomplished, but yet it's progressive. God told the nation of Israel to celebrate this Passover feast until God would tell them. And as a matter of fact, he said forever. They're still celebrating it today. This table also led us to the tables of the Ten Commandments. Because this table tells us about a compassionate God, a delivering God, a God that provides for us, but also he's very righteous. He's not a God that you can manipulate. He's not a God that you can cover his eyes so he cannot see what you're doing. He's a compassionate God, delivering God, a provisional God, but also he's righteous. That's why he gave us the Ten Commandments, written on tablets of stone so that everybody could see exactly what he's talking about. And I always like to concentrate on the first commandment. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make any images of anything that is in heaven or in the earth below or in the waters beneath the earth, and you shall not bow down to them and worship them, for I am a jealous God that visited the iniquity of the first, second, and third, and fourth generation of them that hate me. But I also will do justice and blessings to the people that love me. The first commandment is very crucial to understand that it's on the table, and that's exactly what God means. Not to be able to, for somebody in their smarts trying to twist the word of God. God does not like to share his glory with anyone. God will not share his glory with anyone because the glory belongs to God himself. There's nothing in this world that will shine that glory, only God. And when Jesus came into this world, in John chapter 1, it says that the Word became flesh, and we saw the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and full of truth. That glory that belongs to God came to us in the person of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen? Okay. As we progress, the table in the book of Genesis ended up in this table here, and that tells us that there's going to be more. So then we go to the table of King David, Psalms 23. And it shows us the character of God between this table and that table over there. Because King David wrote this psalm, being a man that walked after the heart of God, he fell into sin also. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. That's what King David said, because he had experienced God exposing him to the sin that he was living in, that he thought that God didn't know about. But yet he sent Nathan to expose him, and Nathan exposed him. So now he writes a psalm, Psalm 51, by the way, it's in regards to that, but Psalms 23 also has a bearing on that. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. In other words, this is what David is saying. He prepared a table in the presence of my enemies, In other words, my table is consisted and has on the table all these blessings that that table was talking about. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. In other words, he's telling us today, you can trust on God. You can trust on God. He will make you to have peace. You will enjoy the presence of God and you will go forward in your life and be able to bring honor and glory to God. At the very end, Psalm 23 says, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's why my cup runneth over. Because he knew what was on the table. It was visible, but yet eternal celebration. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So all these things are on this table here. And then we go to the table that we're going to talk about this morning. And I read the passage of 1 Corinthians. You know, people in the world, by nature, we're all idol worshipers. Because there's, in our characteristics, we have a lot of times, we develop this a lot of times, superstition and doubt and fear and all those things that have to do with this particular table here. This particular table has been present ever since the creation of the world. Just like the table of the Lord was evolving, this table was evolving too. And then some of the nations that worship idols inflicted that in the people of God. Not to say the least, Egypt were idol worshippers also. So when the nation of Israel came out of Egypt, by norms, they had been infiltrated and influenced by the idol worshiping in Egypt. But God brought them out. That's why he brought the first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before me. But now Paul, dealing with the church, 4,000 years later, dealing with the church, he tells them very explicitly, flee, beloved, flee from idolatry. Flee from idolatry. It doesn't mean stick around, maybe you'll learn something. He doesn't say that. He says flee, run away, get away from idolatry. Why does Paul say that? Because in his experience, he had known that idol worshiping will grasp you like an anchor in your soul, in your mind, and it will produce fear and doubt. And it is not the right thing to do when we have a living God that is alive, that is living inside of us. And let me go back a little bit on this table here, because there's a lot of things that we need to say. First of all, this table is associated with a wide and broad road that Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 7. It says there's a wide road and there's a narrow road. The wide road takes you to destruction. I'm paraphrasing. The wide road takes you to destruction, but the narrow road takes you to eternal life. There's two roads. And let me say something, hermano. The narrow road is not very popular with people, because the narrow road has a lot to do with getting away from this table here, because this table, as demons or worship here, there's a lot of things that happen that keeps people going. Evil speaking comes in the wide road. Evil speaking and jealousy. You know, these are emotional things that are normal in humanity that don't have the Lord. Now, there's people that have the Lord that still have all these things. That's why Paul says, flee from idol worshiping. You got to flee from that. Because also, it says here that behind every idol, there is a demon. People don't understand that. They don't believe that. But behind every statue that people bow down, behind every statue that is constructed of iron, gold, silver, stone, clay, whatever the case may be, now they have plastic, don't they? A lot cheaper. Any idol that is constructed with the imagination of a man, thinking that they're making something that is in heaven. It says very clearly in Exodus 20, thou shalt not make any images. Images meaning a work of your mind. Any statue that is made in a fabric or with human hands or a painting and tell the people that that's God himself, that's an idol. Behind every idol, there is a demon. It is not just in the New Testament. This goes back to the Old Testament. In the book of Deuteronomy, Moses talks about the fallen spirits. Deuteronomy chapter 32 and Psalms 96 talks about the people, the heathens, worship devils through idol worshiping. Any idol, you may say, well, this is the image of Jesus Christ. It is not Jesus Christ. It is an image. It is made of gold, it is made of silver, made of clay, it is made of wood. It is not Jesus. Jesus is in heaven. Amen. And not only is he in heaven, but the Holy Spirit is inside of you. Amen. You know, when we bring this conversation out to people that are by nature idol worshipers, and we tell them about this, he said, we're not worshiping the idol. It's just reminding us of God. Don't you know that God is in your heart? If you have Jesus in your heart, you don't need to see anything. You have him in your spirit. Because you see, the Word of God says that God is spirit. He's not a man, he's a spirit. He doesn't have a body, he's a spirit. And God is looking for people to worship him in spirit and in truth. We don't have to be looking at a statue. We don't have to be looking at a picture. We're looking at Jesus spiritually in our heart. Amen. That's why God hates idolatry. And I'll say that again very loudly and clear. God hates idolatry with a passion. That's why the nation of Israel, and by the way, everything that happened to them happened for an example for us today. They had to end up in Babylonia. They had to end up under the ruling of other nations because of idol worshiping and among other things. But God hates idol worshiping. We cannot partake of this table here and that table at the same time. This table, it's also progressive, just like that one over there. It's going to lead somewhere. That one is leading to this one here. And this one is leading to eternal life. But this one is leading to destruction. Because there's a lot of things that will cause destruction. And some of them is, of course, idolatry. I like this one here. Can you all read it? Can you say it out loud? Oh, there's nothing wrong with drinking a beer. According to a lot of people, right? But the Word of God says that if you're walking in this wide road and beer is a part of your life, or alcohol or drugs or anything like that, you're actually on the wide road. Sooner or later, you're going to end up where this road is going to take you. Right now, you cannot see the end of it. Because you might be young, because you might be overtaken by the feelings of all these things that are here, but it's going to lead you to a destruction. One day, you're going to come to the end of the road. And what a surprise. Because at the end of the road, if you're still alive and breathing, Jesus will be waiting for you. But if you die in that condition, you're going to have to pay for your own sins. All these things are on this table here. Selfishness, ambitions. Oh, this one is pretty good too. Can you read that? Huh? Everybody thinks it's just natural for that to go out with a neighbor's wife. It's only natural. That's life. That's not life. That's destruction. It is destruction. Listen, folks, I told you that I was going to expose the demon workers on this table here. I'm not going to be around the bush. Witchcraft. Oh, but I'm not a witch. But you manipulate, don't you? Huh? Manipulate your husband or manipulate your wife. You know, manipulation is a form of witchcraft. And actually, humans practice witchcraft on a daily basis. We cannot be partakers of that table over there and this table at the same time. This table here, you're actually, when you participate in it, you are worshiping demons. I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Ephesians very quickly. Ephesians in chapter 6 and verse 10. Ephesians 6:10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. We don't battle against flesh and blood, folks. We're battling against the spirits around that are in the heavenly places. And let me kind of give you something in a little practical side. The evil spirits are here, and they're messengers of Satan. And they came to disrupt the things of God. They didn't come to disrupt anything else other but the things of God. They're not going to disrupt the bartender and the drunks that are in the bar. They're going to be all right. They came to disrupt the church. They came to disrupt the people that are trying to know God. And he does that by lying. He does that by bringing false doctrines and false teachings so that people will not engage in the truth. And when he does that, people will be far and away from the things of God, and they will be on this table here worshiping devils. And you know, a lot of people are so afraid of the devil, brother. The devil with horns, and he's red, and he's ugly, and a long face and stuff like that. But actually, they worship him every day. They're playing with him every single day. And they don't realize, when they're kneeling down in front of a statue, and they worship that statue, thinking that that's reminding them of God. And in other words, God is saying, I don't live in that statue, by the way. I can live in your heart. If by faith you accept me to come in, I will come in, and I will be with you, and I will put you on the narrow road. And the amazing thing is this, that when we come to the narrow road, all of a sudden we realize that was a wide road. See, when you're over here, you can't see the difference. Because you have a tendency of justifying yourself. Well, everybody does it. I mean, why can't I do it too? I mean, everybody goes there. Why can't we go too? I mean, after all, I saw some Baptists over there the other day, and they were having a ball. Did that hit home? I believe it does. Because there's religious Baptists. There's religious Catholics, there's religious Presbyterians, there's religious people that they justify themselves, and they think that they can play around with the table and also be thinking about that table there. It doesn't work like that. Let me tell you what goes on. And I was looking at these two objects here. This is very clear to be able to illustrate what I'm saying. Clear because this represents God. His word is clear. His message is clear. This one hides what's in there. It could be coffee, it could be chocolate, it could be milk, or it could be bourbon. You can't see it. I've seen people that are in the public places drinking out of the cup, and they drink out of the cup all day long. You have to conclude, maybe it's not coffee. But here's these two objects that I'm going to illustrate something to you. When you come to the table of the Lord, a lot of Christians, this represents a lot of Christians, by the way, but they want to bring this here to the table of the Lord and this here. Because they're in church Sunday morning and they love the word. They like it so much. They even feel committed. They feel guilty about sin and stuff like that. Convicted, better word. But yet, they're learning the truth. They're learning the truth. But they put it against the hidden thing. That makes sense to you? This is why we have a lot of Christians that do not understand Christianity. And let me tell you something about the people that do not understand Christianity well. They don't enjoy Christianity because they want to be over here. I mean, they made the sacrifice of being here, and they listen to the word, they like the word, but yet they got hidden things in their lives. And that cannot happen, because when you come to this table, you're going to be exposed. The first thing that the Holy Spirit does, when you say, God, forgive me of my sins, you know what's going on in your life? Right there, the Holy Spirit has convicted you of what was hidden inside of you. You cannot come to Jesus and say, I want to receive Jesus, but I want to keep all this garbage inside. I don't want nobody to see it. And Pastor, you better not talk about me Sunday morning, because I'll walk out of the church. Let me hide it here, but I want this here. It's not going to happen like that, folks. I've got news for you. You're either with the Lord or you're against with the Lord. Against the Lord or with the Lord. You cannot be right in between. There's no such thing. So these people over here do the same thing. They worship devils, but they bring the Word of God in and they put it there. There's nothing wrong with witchcraft. There's nothing wrong with idolatry. There's nothing wrong with adultery. There's nothing wrong. I know the Bible backwards and forwards. Can you see this? It's over here on this table. I know the Word of God. Have you ever heard people say, I know what to do. I know that I'm doing wrong. I know. Well, why don't you get out of it? If you know what you're doing wrong, get out of it. I mean, it doesn't get any more clear that you're playing around with God, and Paul said you cannot do that. You cannot put the Word of God here and the hidden things in here and think you're doing good. You got to get over here, put the Word of God here and these hidden things over here, because that's where they belong. We have been rescued from this table here. We have been rescued, and that's why Paul is saying flee from idol worshiping. Because behind every statue, behind every picture that people bow down and worship, there's a demon there. You know what the Word of God says in the first commandment? He's going to visit the iniquity of the first, second, and third, and fourth generation of them that hate me. And this, till this very day, people don't understand. People still don't understand why they go through what they go through. But yet, they have idols all over the house. I'll never forget this lady that she was going through a problem in her marriage. And she called me. Said, I'll go over. So me and my wife goes over and we started witnessing to her. She's a very, very strong Catholic woman. Very strong Catholic family. And I knew I was going to have an uphill battle, but I decided to take the challenge. So when I got there, and I didn't want to do anything else other than help her, and I looked at her house, and she had idols all over. Statues, pictures, crucifix. I mean, she had everything there. I mean, you would think you were in the church somewhere. And then she told me her problem. And me and my wife, we presented a plan of salvation. She gave her life to Jesus. And a week later, she calls me again. Pastor, can you come again? It happened again. Oh, okay. Me and my wife go again, and we prayed with her, and we comfort her. And then the third week, Pastor, can you all come again? Every Saturday, man, I couldn't do anything else, just go to the house. So we go to her house, and I said, man, I'm tired of this. I really am. I want to be home with my kids, with my wife, and these ladies over here having problems, and she can't see normally. So I said, lady, let me tell you something. As long as you have those idols on your wall, you're going to be calling me every Saturday. So I want to cut it out. And the only way to cut it out is to give you the truth. The only way to cut it out is to tell you that behind every statue that you have there, there's a demon. And if you don't think that demons cause problems in marriages, let me tell you, I know for sure that it does. Not only because the Word of God says it, but I've been through it myself. And the lady got a little hurt. But she got over it. And she became a Christian. Amen. See, we cannot hide. We cannot pretend that it's all right for you to have this over here and partake of the Lord's table. And nobody's gonna tell you anything. Don't worry. The Baptist church, the pastor don't care. You can go out there and just put it together. Learn the Word. It's clear. Can you see? Clear. But this one, you don't know what's in it. Everybody thinks they can hide it from God. And when we don't preach the truth, when we don't turn the coin, and we let them know what's on the other side of the coin, they're going to walk out through those doors and say, man, the sermon was great, the fellowship was great, the singing was good, and nobody told me anything about, nobody asked me anything about this here, and I have this here. So I have two things. Nah, that don't be there. I'm there. Then there, and then there. Have you ever heard people say,
Well, I open the doors of my house to anybody that talks about God. Huh? Because everybody believes in God. So we open our doors and we receive all religions to come into our house. Do you know what you're doing? Do you know what you're doing? You're accumulating more garbage in your life. You don't accept religions into, you're already fed up with religion. Religion is not getting you out of any problems. And you're getting more religions in there. No. Get somebody that will introduce you to a fellowship, to a relationship with God. Because when you have a relationship with God, He's going to come to your heart and He's going to deal with you inside, not just here, but in here. And when He deals with you in your heart, then you're going to know that it is God dealing with you. You know, I always tell people, you know, I can tell people till I'm blue in the face, don't do this, don't do that, act like this, act like that. And when I say it, it's not going to have any effect on their life. But when God tells them, then they're going to change. I can't change anybody. I can't make my own kids do anything that I want them to do. I used to have a dog. That dog never did mind me. I can't get anybody to do what I want them to do. But if I preach the Word of God, if I get people to understand what's here, God Himself will tell you what you need to do. And when that happens, then it can be attributed to my effort that God is doing through me as a prophet that has good fruits. I don't want to be a prophet that has bad fruits. I don't want to be a prophet, a pastor, a preacher, a teacher of the Word of God, and not produce good fruit in people's lives. Let me tell you how that could be reversed. If I'm the kind of a pastor that I never address these issues here, then I'm going to have bad fruits. Because the fruits are not going to be according to you, it's going to be according to God. God is the one that examines our fruits. And if our fruits are not just in the Word of God, hermano, we are responsible before God for what we're preaching and teaching. So you as an audience, you as a member, you as a person that is here by the grace of God, make sure and understand that I want to be accountable to you. I want to be accountable so you can see that we're talking from the Word of God. We're preaching from the Word. This is not a Baptist thing. This is not a Catholic thing. This is not a Presbyterian thing. This is the living Word of God. And the living Word of God will make a difference in your life. What we need to do, first of all, is follow the instructions of Paul. Flee from idol worshiping. Flee. Don't play around with it. Don't keep it in a place where nobody knows and you keep it in there. That happened to me when I first became a Christian. And I went home and I had all those idols. My wife had an altar and all those things and candles everywhere. And huelía muerto allá adentro. And I remember that I took some of those idols and I felt sorry for them. I went and put them in the garage. Allá donde tenía las cokes y tenía todo, allá los puse escondiditos. That's Spanish, by the way. It's not tongues. I put them in the garage, all those idols, and I'm thinking that nobody's going to find out about them. I'm going to leave them there, and I'm going to be all right. When I hear Brother Soma, I mean, he's not going to get on my case anymore. Because he was good at that, let me tell you. Well, one day I got convicted. So I started asking. Of course, I already knew what I need to do, but I started asking to just confirm. What do I do with these things? Break them, they told me. My God. Break them? Break them. What if I give them to my aunts? They're strong Catholic. No. Break them. And then it dawned on me, that's right. Because if I don't break them, somebody is going to have the curse on them. So by the grace of God, I went and broke all those de barro, the plastic. But I'll be truthful with you. I kept one of them. The reason I kept it is because it was a crucifix and the little monito there had his legs broken. So I tried to put it back. And I felt sorry for him, you know. So I said, man, I'm gonna put it on top of the refrigerator and I'm gonna put the little leg on there. I'll deal with it later. By that time, God had already called me to preach. And I went to Zapata, Texas to preach over there in three different churches. I was a brand new Christian, by the way. So I started preaching, and I brought a message like this. The reason I brought the message is because in that area, there's a lot of idol worshiping. And I brought a message, and I told them about the idols. And this old lady, they used to go to church here. Every time that she would come out of the service, I would be greeting the people as they went out, just like I do here. And that old lady, she was so sweet. She would come over and hug me and say, "Mijito, I love the word, the beautiful word." And she would hug me, and I thought she was something else. But one day I go to visit her house, because she was sick in Zapata. When I walked in that house, I was amazed. She had idols in the bathroom. She had idols on top of the bed, on top of the couches, on top of the chairs. She had, I don't know where she laid down to sleep, because the whole bed was full of idols. I'm not kidding you, folks. And when I brought that message up, instead of kissing me, she went like this and walked out. And I said, "Man, it must have been because of the preaching." It was. It really was. She said, "You are so mean," she told me. "I am?" She said, "Yes." Okay. Well, I came home. When I came home, my wife says, "Hey, honey, where's that letter that we received the other day? It's on top of the refrigerator. Can you get it for me?" And me being short, I had to get a little letter. I climb up so I could see. And you know, the surface of the refrigerator is flat. I saw the letter there, and on the side of the letter, there was the little crucifix with the leg broken. And so, oh my God, I just preached about this, and here I am feeling sorry for this piece of clay or plastic. I said, "What do I do?" I took it, the trash can was right there, threw it in the trash can. I know what it is to be under the influence of idol worshiping. Nobody can tell me any difference. I know exactly how it grabs you, how it produces superstitions, how it brings fear and doubt to your life, and how it sets you on the wide road. Because when you're on the wide road, that superstition, those devils, those demons, are tricking you into thinking that everything's all right. You can be selfish, you can be a drunkard, you can practice witchcraft, you can do anything that you want to, any way everybody does it, any way God is love, He loves everybody. Let me tell you, my God is love, but He's also a righteous God. Amen. And when He tells us, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me," that's exactly what He means. Amen. Nothing to be interpreted. Nothing to be, so somebody said, "Well, that's how you interpret the Bible." That's what it says on there. "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." So when people have idols in their home, when they have idols in their offices, let me tell you something, it is the truth. Amen. There's demons behind every idol. How can you have a good business? How can you enjoy a good relationship with family? How can you enjoy your work or anything when idols and demons are all around you? They don't want you to be happy. The Word of God says, Jesus Himself said, the devil came not for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Amen. Do I need to repeat that again? This is what Jesus says in the Gospel of John, chapter 10. The devil came not for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I am come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. You need to switch over from this table to this table here. Amen. And we're going to be talking about this table next week. You don't want to miss it. Because when we close on this table here, we're gonna expose everything on this side over here. And you're going to be so happy. You're going to be so thrilled. Because you're going to see spiritually what God is doing in your life. Amen? Please stand. So I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I know that God touched your heart. I know that there's still a lot of people here that are under the influence of idol worshiping. I know there's still a lot of people that have fear. We don't hate you. We love you. We hate what's happening to you, but we love you. God loves you. God loves you so much that He gave His only Son, so that if you believe in Him, you will have eternal life. You will not have to be condemned. You don't have to go on that wide road that leads to destruction. You can switch over to the narrow road. And you can switch over completely, not half and half, but completely. Some people may say, well,